5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
What would you report?
Jesus Christ, you better... Sheriff, Gina!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. The rumors of my demise are highly over-exaggerated. I'm just sick. Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. Got a great show planned for you this evening. As you can tell from my voice, I'm still fighting this cold. I'm feeling better and better every day. I appreciate everyone's kind emails and Facebook messages. Very kind of you guys to send those to me. I am doing better. I am starting to get over this cold. You'll just have to please excuse my voice tonight. Remember, if you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. And if you get a chance, check out the website, sasquatchchronicles.com. How's everyone doing tonight? Thank you again for being here. Got a fascinating account tonight of two hunters. They actually came across a Sasquatch, but there was a buildup to their sighting. And it fascinates me when people aren't involved in this topic and they start to have an experience and they can't really place it. And so there's, especially hunters, they don't really know what box to put experiences in. And so they tend to brush things off. And that's what happened tonight when he listened to Kyle's encounter. And I've actually changed his name. His real name's not Kyle because of his profession. He asked me to change his name, so I did. So tonight we will call him Kyle. And again, I really want to jump into it tonight. I think you guys will find this to be a very fascinating encounter. Kyle gives some great descriptions. Kyle, welcome to the show. Thank you for being here tonight.
Thanks, Wes.
And if you would, where did your encounter take place? What state?
I live in Long Island, which is in New York. Long Island is like the furthest part of like New York State. I do most of my hunting upstate in like the Catskill Mountains or like the Adirondack Mountains, something like that. But this particular situation happened in the Catskills.
Okay, and how long ago did this encounter take place?
This happened on February 5th of this year.
Oh wow, so it's really recent.
Yeah, it was only, today's 20 days ago, something like that.
Yeah, that's crazy. Well, if you would, start from the very beginning. Tell us what happened. Tell us what you're out doing and just kind of walk us right into it.
Okay. I hunting and all kinds of outdoor stuff upstate. I take my family camping up there every year. And I've been going up there since I was a kid. My parents took me up there when I was little. So naturally, when I'm doing my outdoor stuff, I'm drawn to go up there. So me and my brother hunt up there, big game, small game. we predator hunt up there, we hike, we do all that stuff. So deer season's over here in New York State in February. So there's a coyote tournament that like a sportsman's club up in the Catskill region puts out to. It's a statewide tournament. So it takes place on a Friday, a Saturday, and a Sunday, which was February 5th, 6th, and 7th. So me and my brother saw an ad that we get in like a hunter paper for this tournament. And we got like all jazzed up about it. And we were like, you know, let's go do it. Cause it was a $2,000 winning prize for the heaviest coyote. So we, you know, made plans, went up there. We really didn't want, we spend a lot of time up there in deer season and we don't own a home or anything like that up there. So we wind up spending like a couple bucks, you know, on hotels or whatever to stay up there during deer season. So we would just said, you know what, let's just stay in because I got a big pickup truck. Let's just sleep in the pickup truck, you know, crash out because most of coyote hunting is done at night. So we drove up, figured we would go to one of our spots that we would normally deer hunt, which is, like I said before, which is in the Catskill Mountain Range. Probably only about, I mean, at the most, it's about an hour and 45 minutes out of like New York City proper, like Manhattan. So we drove up to our spot, which we call it the Beaver Dam spot. So we park our truck at a trailhead and then we have to walk from the trailhead. We have to walk. It's a good 3/4 of a mile to a mile in from the truck into our spot where we would hunt. So we got up there probably around 4 o'clock in the afternoon, still daylight, no snow on the ground, nothing like that. Figured let's go get all our gear out there, you know, while we still have daylight, and we'll shoot back into town, grab a bite to eat, and then once the sun set, we'd go back to our spot. That's exactly what we did. We went, set all our stuff up, came back to the spot. It was probably around 9 p.m. when we finally got there. Got all set up, changed our clothes, you know, put on like super warm clothes. It was really cold that weekend. It was probably like at night. It was down into the teens, maybe even single digits with the wind. Got all our clothes on, walked to our spot, got into our blind. We hunt my brother hunts with a shotgun, 12 gauge, and I hunt with a, this particular night, I was hunting with a Remington 700 308. We also employ night vision when we hunt, and like green lasers and stuff like that. So if you don't want to use your night vision, and because once you turn that night vision on, it's not like looking through a scope, it's like looking through a television screen, so it's bright in your eye. So once you do that, you kind of ruin your natural night vision. So I like to keep that off as little, you know, I like to keep it off as to not ruin my night eyes, you know? So we both have, I have a rifle scope that's night vision, and my brother has like a monocle that he would just hold up almost like a monocular. So we get into our blind and we get all set up. I use like an electronic game wall. That's like a wireless kind of like device. I use it for deer. I use it for everything. So I set it out away from the blind, probably maybe like 75 yards, nothing crazy. So me and my brother were talking real quick. Like, what do you want to start, you know, start calling with? Do you want to start calling with a wounded rabbit, or do you want to go straight for like, you know, coyote, like howls and communication howls and stuff like that. So my brother was like, go for the rabbit. Just let it run out and like let's see what kind of responses we get. So we let out on the rabbit call. Initially we really got nothing off the rabbit call because I don't know if you're a hunter or if you've ever coyote hunted, but when you call for a coyote, they're gonna be there within minutes. I mean, from the time you call to the time you're gonna hear them come in or start like yipping, because they like start yipping when they get excited, you'll hear them coming in because they usually come in groups. It could be you make your first set of calls and within 45 seconds you got like three dogs within sight, or it'll go where you'll call and call and call and call and get nothing. So I let out my first string of calls. We really got very little response. So I said to my me and my brother, you know, conferred again real quick, and he was like, you know, switch it over to coyote and let's see if we get a response from anything in the area. So we flipped it over to coyote. I let out like a big, like long string of, it's on the game call. It says, coyote, like, I don't know if it was a rally howl or just a communicative howl, something like that. So I let that play out and we got some calls back, but the calls back, you could tell they're from miles away. It was very faint. So we let out another string of the coyote howls, very faint, very, very faint response. So we just kind of hung out for a while. Let's go easy on the calling because we didn't want to scare everything away. So let's go easy on the calling. So that's when we're both kind of just hanging out, not really saying anything. And we started to hear like an owl. Now we have in New York State, we have barred owls. And I'm pretty sure we have great horned owls, but I've never really seen one out in the woods. Barred owls, you'll see all the time. They're big, big owls. And they make a lot of noise. So we heard an owl hooing, and it was only maybe, I don't know, 50 yards away. It sounded like it was elevated up in a tree branch. But it just didn't sound right. It started off with its hoo, and then it let out like another hoo. But something just didn't sound right about it. It sounded like louder than it really should have been. I guess we really didn't think anything of it. It continued to go on. And then it started to get like a response hoo from, now where we hunt, where we placed our blind, there's like a small, like maybe like a 1 acre clearing in that we would use like as our vision in front of us. For where the animals would come in. Across that that clearing, it just goes basically straight down into like a beaver dam. There's all kinds of like big tree falls down there. Beavers are real busy down there, and it's all flooded. And then on the opposite side of that, it goes straight back up like another side of a mountain. So we're on one side of a mountain, and then there's the beaver dam, and then it goes back up another side of the mountain. So we hear the response hoos from the owl sounds, I mean, they sound like this owl, which doesn't sound as we've heard in the past. So we both kind of look at each other and we're like, this doesn't sound right, you know, like, but we couldn't really see them. That's the whole thing. Like the whole time, as soon as I heard the first one, cause you know, you have night vision, you want to play with it. I immediately clicked on my night vision and I was looking for the owl. From the sound I was getting off of it, I almost felt like I could just turn on my night vision, point my night vision up at that tree branch, and there it was going to be. But it wasn't. Me and my brother both looked. We could not find the owl. Now we're getting response howls from across the, like what we call the beaver dam, across the beaver dam, going up the other side of the mountain. And now they're getting like more frequent, like back and forth relatively quickly. And then it all just kind of stopped. And from the time we first heard the first owl to the time both of them stopped making noise, it was like really, it was probably like a good hour. I mean, even maybe like 40 minutes. It was a long time these things were making noise. Basically, we heard the owls. Like, basically out of nowhere, we heard one loud hoo, another loud hoo, almost like they were right next to each other. But it wasn't the same owl. You could just hear it. It wasn't the same owl. And then it went, like, hoo, hoo, and then it was everything completely changed from two owls to what I can only describe as, I know it's going to sound crazy, it sounded like a legitimate monkey. Like an excited screaming monkey. Now, the barred owls, you can even look it up on like YouTube and stuff like that. Cause this is what I've been doing since this happened. You know, I've been like trying to find all the information I can, you know, all this kind of stuff. There's a thing that people call it like when they laugh, they call it laughing. Like barred owls make a noise that kind of sounds, I don't want to say it sounds like laughing, but if the owl were to laugh, I guess that's what it would sound like. But this was not that. And my brother turned, as soon as we heard it, my brother turned to me and it was like, what, you know, what the F was that? And I, like, you know, hair on the back of my neck was standing up. As this happened, it was like it was like instantaneous. It went like hoo hoo, and then it was like the monkey, the straight up monkey, like screaming. That's the only way I can describe it. It was like screaming laughter, like excitement. And then as that happened, we heard loud bipedal running right behind our blind. We have like a pop up blind. It sets up in 2 seconds. We both sit in it side by side, and we both look out the same direction. The front windows like zip open, the sides zip open, the back zips open. But we didn't, now it was so cold that night and windy that we had like a little tiny like little space heater going in there too, like a little camping like propane heater. We didn't have the back windows open to try to keep some of this heat in, try to keep some of the warmth and the wind out. But I think even if we had had the back screens open, when this thing ran by, we were so tight in there, like next to each other, that we couldn't even like turn around to really do anything. But we both heard it. My brother, like, he got so, now this is the guy I've been hunting with. I'm 31 years old. I've been out hunting for as long as I can remember. I've been out in the woods with my father, my grandfather. I've never been scared in the woods. Like, for the most part, you know, when you're a little kid, you get like spooked in the woods. But as like an adult, I've never been scared in the woods. There's never been anything that I was unsure of or couldn't tell you like in 2 seconds, like, oh, that was a bear. That's a coyote. That's, you know, a deer. Don't worry about it. It's no big deal. But my, you know, when I saw that my brother was like nervous, that made me nervous. You know what I mean? Like, because he doesn't, you know, he's the same way as me. When we go hunting, we go together. We never go alone. We never do anything by ourselves. Probably mostly because, you know, my mother like guilted us that we were, you know, something terrible would happen to us if we didn't, you know, go with each other ever since we were little kids. So like when I looked over at my brother and saw like, cause when this thing ran behind us, my brother like grabbed my arm. And he's like, what the F was that? And I was at that point, I was nervous because I had no, like, it was, we heard the screaming in front of us, the running behind us. Now I know what a coyote sounds like when it runs in on you, even in the middle of the night. You know, they're very light on their feet. They don't come in like a bear or something like that. Like they're not lumbering. They're not heavy. They're very light on their feet. They're very swift, very quick.
When you heard that bipedal footsteps, it threw you off, didn't it? You knew right away.
Absolutely. Absolutely. When we had gotten back to the truck, I don't mean to skip ahead, but my brother had said to me, he said that was all like very, and the way he described it was good. He said it was all just very confusing. Like everything was happening all at the same time. So like we have this screaming like in front of us, running behind us, like, I don't know where to look. Like, my instinct was to turn around and look, you know, like, look behind me. But I couldn't see anything because the flaps on the blind were up. So, like, after that, everything just kind of stopped. As this was all going on, we heard the running, we heard the screaming. And as soon as it started, like, as fast as it had started, it had stopped. You know, and then it was just quiet. So we immediately got our night vision up, started looking, and we saw nothing. We saw nothing, heard nothing else after that. And then I think we were both a little spooked, and my brother was like, listen, he's like, this was probably like 12:30, 1 o'clock at night, ultimately, after we finally, like, you know, pulled the plug, and we're like, listen, let's call it a night. You know, let's go back to the truck, let's get some sleep, and, you know, let's come back in the morning and break our blind down, because we hunt like multiple spots. So we were going to, you know, we really didn't have any success there. We were going to break our blind down in the morning and take it to a place we call the farm. Like it's like a farm, another place that we hunt upstate. So we went back to the truck. We woke up the next morning, went back up to retrieve our blinds. And my brother, it was much warmer after the sun had come up the next morning. We were able to, you know, dress a little lighter, and, you know, the walking was a little easier. But I told my brother, I was like, listen, I was like, I'm going to take my rifle, you know, because I was like, you know, I want to win this coyote tournament. You know, like, I'm not going to walk, you know, a mile into our hunting ground without the gun. You know, what if I, you know, because we were just going to basically in to break our blind out. We weren't going in to hunt. So I was like, take your shotgun with you. You know, I'm going to take my rifle. And he's like, nah, he's like, I don't want to carry my shotgun. He's like, I'm just going to, you know, we got to carry gear out. He's like, I don't want to carry stuff in. So we, you know, I took my rifle and we walked in. And the trail from where we park our truck to, like the top of the trail, it's probably like, I would say a good 3/4 mile, something like that. Mostly uphill, very rocky. The Catskills is like a huge, it's basically like a mountain range that was formed by like glacial deposit. So everything is like gigantic boulders and, you know, all like loose stone and flat river rock and stuff like that. So like the, you know, very rocky uphill, it's kind of a tough walk in. I'd say about like, when you get to the very top of the trail, because years and years and years ago, all this land, the Catskills at one point were clear cut and they were all used as farmland. So none of the trees and stuff are really like old growth. None of the stuff is really, you'd have to go up like to the Adirondacks, which is like 500 miles from where I live, to really get like big old growth forest, stuff like that. The Catskills is, you know, maybe 100 years old as far as, you know, the trees and stuff like that. So as you're walking through these trails, you can still see like stacked stone, like fencing from where there used to be farmland and stuff like that. So there's like old, like overgrown shrubs and stuff like that. And when you get to the top of this particular trail, there's like a big plot of like bamboo that somebody at one point, I guess, planted for decorative reasons. And I mean, I don't know if you know how bamboo grows, but that stuff is like crazy invasive. So you plant a little bit and it just takes over everything. So we're walking up the trail. My brother's walking in front of me. When we get to the top of the trail, it kind of like levels off. It's no longer like an uphill walk. It's just kind of a flat walk. And that's where the bamboo starts. And as soon as like the trail leveled off and we hit the bamboo patch, and we're not by any means, we're not like running. We're walking slow because we told them, let's take a slow walk in case we do see a coyote, you know, pop a coyote up. So as soon as we got to the top of this bamboo patch, we heard a crazy, crazy low, like guttural, like deep growl. Now I know the noise bears make, and people think, like a common misconception is that, like black bear in New York State hibernate, and they actually don't. They just kind of like rest. They don't sleep. Their heart rate doesn't slow down. So that you can run into black bear, you know, during what would be called like hibernation. They do come out of their dens and stuff like that. We have seen it before. I mean, initially we thought bear. So it was like, but this thing, I could feel it like in my feet, you know. It was like, it was not a bear. It was like a rumble. It almost sounded like a rumble of thunder. That's the best way I can describe it. But it was so close. Like, it was as close to where it sounded like my brother stepped on it. That's how close it was. And my brother stumbled back, took like 2-3 steps back into me. And I had to like put my hand out because he was going to push me off the trail into the bamboo. So I had to like put my hand out to like stop him from pushing me further. And I put a round right into my gun. And we both just stood there and froze. We didn't move because I was waiting for something to come out. Now, on the left-hand side of the trail on our walk in, there were two big trees that were falling over, and they were right like butted up against the edge of the trail. Now, this particular part of the trail where the bamboo is, the trail is almost elevated like a foot, so it's almost like a big it's like a hump. So to the left of the trail and the right of the trail, It's sunken down like a foot to a foot and a half, maybe 2 feet, and that's where all the bamboo sits. So right next to that, right on the edge of the trail going into the bamboo, there were like two huge trees that were falling down, and it sounded like it had come from like right underneath that. But we stood there for a minute, And, you know, I was waiting for, I was legitimately waiting for like a bear to pop up. Finally, my, you know, my brother was like, what are we going to do? And I was like, well, I was like, we came in here to get our gear. So let's just press on and get our gear. You know, the fact remains is that we still have to walk past here to go get, you know, our hunting blind and our chairs and the heater and the stuff we left out there the previous night. So we, you know, just, we, you know, you know, swallowed our pride and just, you know, walked past it, got to our blind, broke it all down, got all of our gear together, and we turned around and walked. Now we're walking back towards the bamboo. Now, when we walked through the bamboo area, it was probably like another 150, 175 yards until we got to where we had placed our blind. So now we're starting to head back into this the trail where this bamboo like thicket starts. So as we're heading down this trail, we hear like a loud huff, like a really loud like exhale, like a deer hunter will know, like a buck snort. It's like the thing like fills its lungs up with air and then like lets all the air out at once. It's pretty impressive thing to see. Like if you're out in the woods, you see a deer do it, like especially like a big buck. It's a pretty impressive thing to see, and it's loud. But this was not like a huff like that. It was like bears also do like a huff type noise. Something had emptied out all its air.
How far away from you did this happen?
This happened. It was no further than like 30 yards away. So we hear this loud huff. Immediately, we both froze because 15 minutes before that, 20 minutes before that, we had just encountered this growl, you know, in the same bamboo thicket. So we immediately stopped. Now I still had a round in my gun. We were both looking around. It's hard, difficult to see anything in bamboo. But we're looking, and now the trail in front of me. I'm my brother's in front of me. I'm behind my brother. The trail in front of me is like a T. So like there's an intersection there. And there's bamboo there too. So as we're looking down the trailhead, we can see. He initially didn't see it, but I was looking through my scope and I could see a dark like a dark object through the bamboo. And when I went up with my scope on my gun, I could see a face, and it was. I honestly didn't even know what to really say to my brother. I told him I said, bro, 30 yards, you know, 12 o'clock, and he picked up. he had his binoculars around his neck. He picked up his binoculars. And he looked, and I don't mean to curse, but he said, holy fuck. I mean, at that point, even still now, I really don't even know how to express how I felt, because I don't know, I don't know if I was nervous, or I still can't even, I think basically what happened I feel like all the adrenaline in my body just like dumped. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know if you've ever been like hiking or something like that and you felt like you were going to fall, you know, and like you feel like you can feel the adrenaline like dump into your body. It makes your whole like body tingle. It's a strange sensation, to say the least. So I'm looking through my rifle scope and, I can see it's I can see what basically what I'm looking at looks like a man. It's covered in like brown, black. The hair wasn't long. It was almost like the hair on what like a German Shepherd. Like it was long, but not like somebody who had long hair. Not like a woman's hair. The face, I could see the face. I could see the face almost down to like right below the lower lip. I mean, now you have to understand there was bamboo, you know, like in front of it, but it had like gray. I could see like hair on its face, I could see that there was no hair on its forehead, and it had like super crazy, like it had like skin like with crazy wrinkles, like it had been lifting like its eyebrows up like for its entire life. You know, its whole forehead was just crazy wrinkles. The skin was gray. The eyes looked very dark, very, very dark. But from what I could tell, the only part of skin I could see on this thing was its forehead. Or, yeah, it was basically its forehead. And I somehow mustered, like, the strength to take one step forward. So I didn't even, like, not even, like, maliciously or menacing. I just basically, like, lifted my foot and put it forward. And this thing, the bamboo, like, snapped back together. And it sounded like there was a Jeep driving through the woods. Like, somebody was, you know, off-roading with their Jeep through the woods. At that point, I looked over at my brother, and my brother was basically... He was, like, beside himself. I tried to talk to him, like, later that day about it, and he wouldn't even really... He almost reacted as if it didn't happen. I know that sounds weird, but that's just kind of... that's just kind of how he... I guess he was dealing with it, or whatever. But I took... Like I said, I took that one step. The thing took off. Like a freight train, turned the complete 180, and through the bamboo it went. I looked over my brother. My brother was, I could tell he was like not really in a good way. So I just basically like grabbed him by the shoulder and I was like, "Come on, bro." I was like, "Let's get back to the truck," because we still had a mile walk back to the truck from where we were. So I knew this thing wasn't right in front of us anymore. So I basically just grabbed him by the arm and I was like, "Let's go." I was like, "Back to the truck." So we basically, you know, double timed it back to the truck. I wanted to like go into where I saw it. You know, I wanted to like walk off trail to where I saw this thing standing. And my brother really wasn't having any of it. And I honestly didn't want to, I don't know. I just didn't want to make my brother not trust that I had good judgment. You know what I mean? Like when you hunt with somebody for long enough and you know, you'll basically, you know, you're putting, like, especially when you go into the middle of nowhere, you gotta rely on the person you're with to, you know, make the right decisions and do what's safe, ultimately what's safe. So my brother was, you know, I didn't really want to press the issue, but I was freaked out completely. I'm still freaked out. I've had nightmares. That night I had nightmares. I haven't told my wife. I have two kids, two little kids. I have a really good job. My brother has a really good job. He successfully owns his own business. But what's weird is that this is like whenever you hear about this kind of like topic or subject, or you never hear about it in New York. I mean, me personally, I've never really heard about it in New York. A lot of the guys that I was raised around who hunted upstate and stuff like that, they were all very like old school, like New Yorkers. You know, it was everything was very like cut and dry. Everything was very black and white. Like there was never any talk of anything that wasn't normal, you know, or anything that you already didn't know of. You're like, yeah, there's, you know, there's deer, there's bobcat, there's, you know, all the small game, all that stuff out in the woods.
I mean, you're not crazy, Kyle. I actually do get a lot of reports out of New York. I wanted to ask you, what was the size difference between you guys and the creature?
Well, that's in the bamboo thicket where we were. Again, I don't know exactly how old the bamboo was, but the bamboo was probably, I mean, it was a good, I'd say between 15 and, you know, 15 and 20 feet, like bamboo stalks. This thing was at least half the way, I would say half the way up, you know, the length of these stalks. So maybe, I mean, you know, 7.5 feet, 8 feet, 8.5 feet. I didn't walk over to where it was standing. I may have been able to get a little better perspective on how big it really was if I was able to put my feet where I saw it. But I didn't see it because I wasn't looking high enough. Like when I was looking, when we heard the noise, I was thinking bear. So I'm not looking at human eye height. I'm looking down, I'm looking for something that's, walks on all fours, isn't close to the ground. So as I didn't see that and I started looking, bringing my eyesight up a little bit and start, expanding my field of view, that's when I saw the figure. And then I looked, had to bring my eyesight up further. And that's when I saw its face. It was a good, it was a good 7 feet, eight feet. I mean, taller than, I have a brother-in-law who's 6'8". And it was, it was a foot taller than him. It had to be.
That's a typical behavior. You took one step forward and I guess it took it as a challenge. And so it decided it didn't want to fight at that point. But, I have heard them run through the woods like you did. And that's, you hit it right on the head. It sounds like someone in a vehicle driving through the woods. I mean, it just is, it's terrifying to hear it. It's terrifying to hear how big they are and how much they can just push the woods. Let me ask you, that night, reflecting back on that night when you guys were in the blind, did it worry you going back in the next day to get your stuff? I realized you wanted to go back in and get your stuff.
I will say that, and I mean, I know you do your research and stuff like that, and so like you go into a spot during the daytime, and it's just a very different environment during the day to during the night. So, I mean, honestly, it was in the back of my mind. I mean, don't think that I wasn't thinking of it. But it didn't stop me at all. I felt no like reluctance to go back or anything like that. I didn't feel like, it was daytime, so I felt like I could see everything. It's fine.
And that makes sense. You're right. It is a different environment during the day than it is at night. What was your take on Sasquatch and Bigfoot and this whole topic before all of this happened to you?
Well, I'm trying to think of like when I guess really became like cognizant of it. Like I said, I'm 31. So when I got to like the age of reason, like television was pretty good. Like they had a lot of like documentary stuff and, unsolved mysteries and stuff like that. And I was always into like the reading and the outdoors and reading books about the outdoors. So maybe when I was like 10 or 12, I probably came across it. And then by the time I was like 15 or 16, like everything was at that point, it had already been like basically like full blown internet. You could look up anything, you could find anything, you can, I remember being like, young and on television, I can't tell you like what television show it was. But I remember being like a little kid and seeing the Patterson film on TV. That to me, I remember seeing that and thinking that was, that, and even to this day, I look at that and that to me looks real. I mean,
you were open to it.
Yeah, I was. Oh, I'm definitely open to it. I'm not, I'm not by any means, Mike. And in comparison, my brother didn't really believe it. Like, didn't really believe it's a thing. Didn't want to believe it. He's like, I had mentioned it to him like years ago. And he was like, who sees Sasquatch? He's like, all the people who report UFO sightings and the same people who see Sasquatch. And I told him, I had started listening to your show. My buddy had turned me on to your show probably like a year ago, maybe a little over a year ago. I as soon as I heard like the first episode, I started like binge listening. And I do love your show. You guys have an awesome show. And to think like that, I'm like telling my story is, I don't know if it's exciting or scary. I still don't really know how to feel about it.
Yeah.
But And my brother asked me, he's like, is it going to, you know, he's like, are you ever going to go back in the woods? He's like, are you ever going to hunt again? And I told him, I said, I think I am. I mean, I don't think I'm going to necessarily go, like, because we also hunt on like a farm, like a piece of farmland, which to me is a little more comforting to be there because you're kind of out in the open. So like, you know, you're not, you know, you're on a farm, you're on land that people live on and travel, but where we deer hunt and stuff like that, where it's all state forest land. So it's completely wild. You know, there's no campsites, there's nothing. There's basically a parking lot with a trailhead. And, you know, if you have the desire to do the 16 mile hike to the summit, you know, go for, you know, all the power to you. But, you know, there's no campsites on the way.
Do you ever go back to, have you ever been back to the spot? I realize this just happened a few weeks ago.
No.
Do you think you'll go back?
I haven't been back there yet. No. It's funny because my brother said, I think maybe we should go back. He's like, well, let's go back. I mean, I would definitely go back. Definitely, I don't think I'd go back at night, you know, initially. But yeah, I would definitely go back. I mean, that's a place that we've been deer hunting for years. So, I mean, and I've never had, you know, and when you deer hunt, you know, you go in, you hunt in the morning, you go in the dark, and you hunt the afternoon, and you come out in the dark. So I've never had any of this experience. And when we deer hunt, we don't hunt together. Like when we were coyote hunting, we were hunting side by side. You know, we were basically like touching shoulders inside the blind. It's more, a little more social than deer hunting. You know, when you're deer hunting or any kind of big game hunting, you want to be as quiet as you can be, you know, making as little noise and movement as you possibly can. So that's, I mean, you know, I've never had any kind of like weird, scary, nothing. I mean, I've never had anything other than this. You know, I've kicked up bears and stuff like that hiking. Cause a lot of places in upstate, New York's gun laws are very, very strict. So, you can't, if you wanted to go like on like a big hike up in the Adirondacks in the summertime or something like that, you can't bring your gun. You're just not allowed. It has to be it can only be armed during hunting season.
I wanted to ask you this. When you're looking at the face of this thing,
yeah,
what stood out to you the most when you're looking at the face? What details stood out the most?
I would say probably its eyes. The eyes looked, like I said, they looked black. They looked like deep inset, like in its head. I could see its eyes blink. So basically, once I saw the dark figure, and I continued my way up till I hit its face, I never really took my eyes off of its face. I think I was probably in shock of what I was even looking at. And I could definitely tell what my brother was just by looking at him. I could tell he was definitely in shock. But the eyes didn't look big. They almost looked small in comparison to its head.
What about the nose?
The nose was pretty flat. Again, that actually the nose really didn't have much hair on it either. It looked pretty flat. It looked like the best way I can describe it is if you made like a person's nose out of Play-Doh and then just kind of like smushed it flat. That's probably the best way I can describe it. But the skin was super wrinkly, like above its. You could see like on its forehead. Its forehead looked tremendous, like tremendous. You can see like deep, it almost looked like scars, like the frown ridges, like in its forehead. It was deep. It looked like leather. It looked like the leather of a baseball mitt, like was just all like wrinkled up. I mean, that's the best way to describe it. This skin looked like it didn't look shiny. It didn't look like you know, like when we get sweaty and stuff, like we get like super oily and our skin gets shiny. It didn't look like that at all. It looked like it looked more like a hide than skin. You know, is that make sense? I don't know if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, no, I do. It's I've had other witnesses report that to me. One lady got a really good look, and she describes it the same way you did. She said, like, dried out leather that was cracked and...
Yeah, exactly, exactly. It was, like, dried, like, animal hide. Like, yeah, that's exactly what it looked like.
Yeah, and thinking back on the encounter, God, you must have been really close for it to growl at you like that. You guys must have really stepped in.
Well, initially when we walked up, I thought my brother, like, stepped on it. I thought my brother stepped on what I thought was a bear. I thought he, like, stepped on it. Like, that's how close we were. And it was, that honestly was probably the scariest part of anything. I know that you'd think, like, seeing it was scary, but sometimes when you don't see things and hear it, it's worse, you know, like, it, because now your mind doesn't have a clear picture of what's going on. You're filling in the blanks, you know? So I was more like, when I saw the creature, I was more
in shock.
I think in shock. Yeah. Than I was frightened. You know, it's hard to explain. I've never felt like that at any point in my life, in any other situation I've ever been in. So, like, it's hard for me to explain, like, how I felt, you know. I'm sure anybody who else has been in a similar situation may even say the same thing. Like, I didn't know, you know, like, I've heard some of the people on your show say that, you know, they felt frozen. Like, I didn't necessarily feel frozen, but I definitely didn't feel like running away was the right idea. You know, I didn't think, like, oh, you know, run, you know, like, this isn't something I know, run away from it. But it was still, I still think about it like 10 times a day. You know, it's still I don't want to tell anybody, you know, I don't know what to make of it. Like, I don't know. I've never even met anyone who's ever had an encounter, ever. I don't know anybody, or if they have, they've never told me, you know, but I know a lot of guys who spent a lot of time in the woods. And I mean, I'm only 31 years old. I mean, I learned to hunt from my father, and my father is almost 70. You know, I've been around guys who have been in the woods their entire lives, and I've never heard anything like this, especially where we live. I mean, you think all this stuff takes place in Canada or, you know, Northern California, Washington State, Oregon, you know, up where you are.
Yeah, it kind of turns your whole world upside down when you see it. It's confusion, it's shock, it's fear, it's like all the emotions kind of thrown in one. And it's hard to process what you're looking at, especially if you've never seen it before, you weren't really expecting it. In your mind, you're thinking bear. But that growl, I know that growl that you heard, and it's terrifying when you hear it. Like, I get completely wooden when you said, hey, the growl almost terrified me more than seeing it.
Yeah, it did. It definitely did. And because that, I mean, that definitely shook my brother. I could tell because he's walked back right into me. And I mean, again, you know, we're avid hunters. Like, I'm not afraid of a bear. You know, I mean, like I said, we were scouting hunting property last year. And, you know, it was before hunting season started, and you can't be armed. And we were hiking, just backpacking in. And we just kicked up a bear. You know, we kicked up a bear 10 feet from us. You know, it was laying down in, like, some tall grass. The trail was super narrow, and it was, like, waist-high grass. And, you know, we just kicked this thing up, and it took off like a rocket ship. Black bears run away from you. I mean, I've never really had any encounters with grizzly bears or anything like that. But black bears, for the most part, they just run. They don't want anything to do with you. And they're not, you know, you're not going to run across an 800-pound black bear. They don't exist. You know, like if you came across a 500-pound black bear, that would be huge in New York State. Huge.
Yeah. No, they are. And black bear aren't really that big. You know, one of the things I was thinking as I listened to your encounter, you know, the fact that there was two of you, and that might have changed the game when you come face to face. If it would have just been one of you, might have been a different story. But the fact that there was two of you, and you know, and that you were armed, probably got it to back off. And you want to be careful going back into areas like that, man. You just, you know, they, you may get a different reaction the second time around if you come across it again.
No, I hear you.
But I definitely understand. I get that you know, your brother wants to go back out there. I mean, I get that. I get that completely. It's curiosity. You know, it's driving you nuts. It's driving you insane right now, thinking about it constantly. And it will for a while. You know, it's something that'll pass for a while. But, you know, it's... That's what great thing about doing a show like this, Kyle. You know, people come on. I've had police officers on. I've had, you know, a Superior Court judge on. I've had people from all walks of life that have seen them. So, you know, not all crazy people see Sasquatch. I would say 99% of the people that see them are completely sane and are in shock, just like you are.
Yeah. Well, like I said, I just can't stop thinking about it. And I want to tell somebody, because I got a couple of friends who I'm like, you know, pretty close with. I'll tell them a lot of stuff, but I won't dare tell them. I don't know. It's strange. It's a strange thing if it's ever happened to you. I mean, and I know it's happened to you, but it's not something I can explain. You know, I can explain it the best my words can explain it, but I can't emotionally explain, you know, the noises and the, you know, it's wild. There's, you know, there's things out there we don't know about.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
You know, I don't know. Especially at night, it's like when you go out in the woods at night, it's a completely different place from the daytime. There's a completely different set of animals that come out. I mean, it's the day to night. It's almost like being in a different place. You can go somewhere at noon and feel totally comfortable and, you know, take your shoes off and lay in the grass. And you can go there at 12 midnight and feel nothing but like dread and be like, I just want to go home. You know what I mean? I just want to get out of here.
Yeah, you're right. At night, it is a completely different feel. You know, a lot of places will go during the day. And you're right, you can lay down, you feel great. Then at night, it's a different type of feeling that you get. But it's a fascinating encounter, man. You'll have to stay in touch with me. Let me know if anything else happens.
Yeah, I will. I mean, I go up there, like I said, that's land that I deer hunt. You know, and I almost don't. I know this is going to sound crazy to some people, but I don't want to, you know, I see a lot of deer in there. I almost don't like want to give it up. You know, I don't want to not go back because of this. You know, it's not going to deter me from going back out in the woods. I'm definitely going back out in the woods next hunting season, and I'll probably be out before that, scout and stuff like that. So, and I mean, I got plans to take my family camping this year. So, yeah, I mean, I'll be out there.
Yeah, well, be safe while you're out there, you know, and you'll be fine. You just, in the situation, you know, like I said, I think you guys drew them in. They thought it was going to be an easy meal with your call.
And yeah.
I know that owl sound, I've heard that in Texas, and it threw me off when I heard it, because it does, it sounds like an owl. What they do in Texas is it sounds like an owl all the way through. It sounds like an owl until the very, very end. And it turned into like a monkey zoo.
Yeah.
One went off, and then pretty soon the other one went off, and then all the owl sounds stopped, and it was all monkey noises.
Yeah, that's what it was. It was crazy. I've never heard anything like it. And recounting it, like, the next day with my brother, you know, I told him, I said, what did you hear? I said, what did you hear those two? Because now, after it happened, you start to get, like, you know, it was just owls. You know, it was just owl. Like, it was, you try to, like, just explain it away. You try to just explain everything away. So I told him, I said, what did you hear? You know, tell me what you heard. And I said, and I'll tell you what I heard. And I said, I heard two owls that turned into, like, monkey laughter, screaming, you know, just confusion. And he said, yeah, he's like, that's exactly what I heard. And, you know, like, that's what it was. It was not, I've heard the barn owl, they called it laughing. I've heard it before, and it was not this. This went from owl to monkey at like the flip of a switch.
Yeah, you're right. It is like a flip of a switch. Yeah. It's, it starts off that owl call you hear kind of gives me shivers thinking about it, you talking about it, because that's how I felt when I was in Texas. I was like, that's a big owl. I was like, it's got a powerful voice. I mean, It sounded like an owl in the beginning. I mean, it had it nailed to a T, but I was like, there's something not right about it. It's just too loud. Yeah. And then towards the end is when they went into the monkey noises, and I was like, oh, no.
Yeah.
And it's funny, you're right, because one will call to another one using that call, but they always screw up the end of it. They always mess up the end of it.
Yeah, I don't know. Nuts.
Well, I appreciate you coming on and sharing it, Kyle, very much. I mean, it was an awesome encounter.
I appreciate you. I appreciate you giving me an outlet to tell someone, or else really I'm the only person, because like I said, I haven't even told my wife. You know, the only people who know, I haven't told my father. I won't tell my dad. I won't tell my wife, because I don't want my wife to be like, I don't want you going up there hunting. You got kids. I feel like I can take care of myself as long as I have my brother with me, there to, keep me safe as I'm going to do famine. I'm not going to be foolish and try to do anything on my own or anything like that. I never have. I never will. It's not worth it.
Well, you guys definitely got the buffet of experiences that night. You know, it's like I always say, they're out there. Some people, they have to see them to believe it. And that's, that's how most people are. I would say I'm like that on a lot of things. But once you see it, man, you'll never forget it. And it'll kind of change your view. I guarantee when you go back, your head will be on a swivel when you go back out there.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure. I'm sure of it. I mean, I remember on our drive home, because it's about a 2.5 hour drive home for me from where we go hunting upstate. And a lot of it is just rural interstate and throughway and stuff like that. And I was like, scanning the tree line. I think I was watching the tree line more than I was watching the cars in front of me on the way home. And just looking, just looking to see if I saw anything.
It'll be like that for a while.
Yeah, yeah. I just don't want it to, I just don't want it to like take over.
Yeah, feel free to give me a call or shoot me a text anytime, man. If you have questions on it, I know you'll probably be looking into it. Feel free to call me anytime, and thank you again for coming on.
All right, thank you. I really appreciate it, Wes.
And that's it for tonight, everyone. Remember, if you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email, wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. Please check out the website, sasquatchchronicles.com. I will see you guys next time. Something acquired.